Welcome back. It's a great honor to open day two of the sixth annual Radosław Global Forum with two of my favorite global thinkers, strategic thinkers, Foreign Minister Radosław Sikorski, Radek Sikorski, and former U.S. National Security Advisor Steve Hadley, a member of the Executive Committee of the Atlantic Council Board. I'm very delighted that we had a dozen board members here today and yesterday, Council. And these aren't just board members, they include former Under Secretary of State, Under Secretaries of Defense, former Vice Chair of the Joint Chiefs, Pentagon Assistant Secretary, and so on, the CEO of the EBRD. The Atlantic Council is made up of a group of individuals who are actors, have been actors in major positions in government and business, including our International Advisory Board, Dr. Brzezinski, Tom Enders, CEO of Airbus. And it's in that spirit that we are a group of actors, not just trying to deliver lofty rhetoric, but also talk about action, what needs to be done, and then try to influence those players and actors who can have impact on great moments of history like this to execute it. Let me briefly introduce Foreign Minister Sikorski, though you all know him quite well. He was born in Bydgoszcz, Poland, graduated from the University of Oxford with a BA and MA in politics, philosophy, and economics. He headed the Student Strike Committee during the unrest in Bydgoszcz in March 1981 and granted political asylum in Great Britain 1982 and 1989. Like all great leaders in the world, he's a former journalist. That's some of you don't realize I was at the Wall Street Journal for 25 years, so that's an inside joke. He was a war correspondent in Afghanistan and Angola in 1986-1989, and he won the World Press Photo Award in 1987 for a photograph taken in Afghanistan. So he knows what it's like to be at the front lines, and he's at the front lines in a much different respect now. He was sworn in as Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Poland 16th of November 2007, very early days in his country's new democratic history. He's been chairman of the Committee of European Affairs since 1st January 2010, elected vice chairman Civic Platform October 2010, and then author of several books, including Dust of the Saints, A Polish House, An Intimate History of Poland. So a writer, a thinker, a strategist. Let me just quote a couple of things from last night's awards dinner. He is a recipient of the Atlantic Council's Freedom Award, but last night he was presenting the award for the people of Maidan. And he told an incredibly moving story about his meeting with Ruslana, who sang the national anthem of Ukraine last evening, quite movingly, where you really got the feeling of being at the heart of decisions. He did say that both Yanukovych and Putin had underestimated the Ukrainian people. But perhaps more to the point, he said, quote, "We are witnessing a moment at which we can imagine a path for Ukraine that makes Ukraine like Poland in terms of prosperity and European future. But we can also imagine a path that makes Ukraine like Syria." I think that's the seriousness of the moment we face. Foreign Minister Sikorski, we look forward to your opening comments and reflections on that, and particularly perhaps a little bit of your reflections on this remarkable week. President Obama coming to Warsaw for your 25th anniversary celebrations, the Ukrainian president's inauguration this morning, the Normandy meetings, the announcement of Putin-Ukrainian talks. We'll have a lot to discuss also after Foreign Minister Sikorski's opening comments and a discussion with Minister Sikorski and Steve Hadley. Foreign Minister.
Hi.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, the title of the panel is The Transatlantic
transatlantic partnership in question. And of course, the question, the challenge is Ukraine. Let me just say, in my more of a think tank mode than my minister mode, so what I'm about to say is what I think and not necessarily what is policy. But the way I see it is that both Russia and us think we are on the defensive. President Putin is very eloquent about it. He sees the West encroaching on Russia's canonical territory, the West trying to prise away Ukraine, that he sees as the original seat of Russian statehood. And never mind how ahistorical it is, because actually, if Kiev and if any country is a successor state to Kiev and Rus, it's surely Ukraine rather than Russia. But I think it's genuinely felt. Whereas we feel we are defending international law, a generally accepted principle of integrity of borders, and so on. And what has happened in Ukraine, what Russia has done in Ukraine, I think does end an era of illusions that the world can be managed one's advantage at the same time. In Europe's case, we've just seen the difference between the southern neighborhood and eastern neighborhood. Because in the southern neighborhood, when we negotiate an association agreement and a deep and free comprehensive trade area with, say, Morocco, that is nobody else's business. Morocco either wants to do it or not, but there is no great power behind Morocco to push back against what Europe is doing. So Europe in the southern neighborhood can do what it is designed to do, which is to manage a slow intergovernmental process to do with synchronization of technical norms, to do with opening markets, to do with making our neighbors a little bit like more like us, by stages, by mutual consent, and to nobody else's harm. And I think what we've just realized that is that in the East, it is different. In some quarters in Europe, there is still the illusion that if we just explain to President Putin what the DCFTA with Ukraine is about, surely he'll come round. And we have had rounds of discussion between the Commission and the Russian Federation, and quite rightly, about explaining to Russia, again, quite rightly, that Russia would economically benefit from a free trade arrangement between Ukraine and Europe. But my thesis is that Russia opposes DCFTA by Ukraine, not because she doesn't understand the implications of DCFTA, but because she understands it all too well. Namely, that 60% of acquis communautaire would start functioning, be applied, become part of Ukraine's law. In other words, Ukraine would leave the post-Soviet legal civilization and join the European legal civilization. And that is exactly what Russia sees as a threat. We think we are just making our neighbors more prosperous, less corrupt, more open to trade. President Putin sees this as a threat to the system that he has established in Russia. And I sort of understand what he means. I don't know when, but at some point in the last decade, Russia ceased to be a candidate member of the West. And let me be absolutely clear, Poland would love Russia to be a candidate member of the West. We think that we will become a normal European country when we have normal European neighbors on both sides of our border, and that includes Russia. But somehow we missed the moment when Russia went off course, stopped converging with us, decided that she is a distinct civilization and a competitive pole of integration, competitive with us. And once you assume that, and President Putin is crystal clear about it, then you have a tension, and countries have to make choices. And Ukraine is in between and has been hesitant about what choice to make. But you do have to make a choice. You either have acquis communautaire or you have all this post-Soviet stuff. And I just don't understand people who say we were wrong to force Ukraine to make a choice. Because some of those things are incompatible. You either start fighting corruption or you enjoy the fruits of kleptocracy. You can't have it both ways. And so what I think this situation is demanding of us is to become clear about what we want. That there is a conflict, there is a tension, and do we want to win, or do we not? Do we not mind if we lose? And you can guess which side of the argument I would be on. We have been faced with a challenge. We have deployed resources, IMF loans, European Commission, macro financing. Ukraine now has a chance to win. But let us let us be intellectually clear what this is about. This is, at bottom, the way I see it, an ideological struggle, again, unfortunately. Namely, which kind of political system will obtain in the post-Soviet space? Will it be kleptocratic, oligarchical system modeled on the Russian Federation, or will it be European-style democracy? And once you phrase it like that, then I think Friends of Freedom have only one choice. So in this sense, and let me finish by that, again, Vladimir Putin has done us a favor because he has forced us to clarify the issues, and he has forced us to make a decision whether we want to prevail or not. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Sikorski, for putting it in such clear terms. Do we want to win or do we not? This is at bottom an ideological struggle, again, unfortunately. These are important statements. Contest between not communism and capitalism, but a kleptocratic oligarchical state and European-style democracy. So that puts it pretty clearly. Let me start with really a question to both of you. Maybe we'll start with Steve. One of the things I love about coming to the Wroclaw Global Forum is you get to sit down with somebody like Steve Hadley, who's advised several U.S. presidents, including being one of 23 men in history who's been a national security advisor to the President of the United States. And you get to sit and talk to Minister Sikorski about the most crucial question of the moment. So I talked to Steve earlier, and I said, you know, okay, what's important to know right now to manage the issue and to take the right action? And Steve actually came up with the three questions I'm going to pose to this panel. And maybe you can start by answering how you would frame this for President Obama or any president of the United States in this kind of situation. We're all talking about Ukraine, but the real issue here might be Putin, as you said. You described Minister Sikorski, how he may be looking at this. What does Putin want? What strategy do you think Putin is preparing to get it? What do we do to prevent it? Let's see if we can handle those three questions. So why don't you start with what does Putin want? And maybe for both of you.
I think Minister Sikorski has framed it intellectually correctly. And his assessment of where Putin is in his thinking, you know, having flirted with coming west and really decided now that Russia has a unique role in history between east and west, if you will, that Russia has done well when it has strong leaders, and this is Putin's moment to be that strong leader that is going to establish a new Russian pillar, if you will. And he is trying to get recruits for that Russian pillar. He's got Belarus, he's got Kazakhstan. Ukraine is important because if Ukraine is part of this Russian sphere, it is an empire. And if it is not, it is more of a distraction and just an extension of Russia. So I think that is really the context. Operationally, what does he want? You know, we've seen, I think, his aspirations grow. I think in Georgia 2008, he wanted to punish a country that had the gall on his border to be democratic and want to move to the rest. And he basically said, if you do that, you'll be punished. Ukraine, I think, is a bigger prize. I think he may have real territorial ambitions. He certainly has a peace in terms of Crimea. And Putin, what we've seen is he's very opportunistic. He takes a long view. He sees an opportunity, he sees it, and his objectives can ratchet up depending how well he succeeds and how much resistance he faces. And Ukraine, I would say, sort of three things of what might ladder up his appetites. Ukraine, clearly, his strategy is to destabilize the East, to try to increase autonomy, to try to give the East a veto power over the decisions the central government will make, and to have a piece of that territory in his control. Because if he can do that, you saw it in Georgia, you now see it in Ukraine, he believes that the West, the EU, NATO, will be reluctant to take into its membership a country that has a territorial dispute with Russia. And so he can keep Ukraine in this limbo, which makes it susceptible to Russian influence and pressure over the long term. Clearly, that's one of his objectives. I think the risk is that if he succeeds and is not opposed, he can go further. And in 2008, we were concerned today Georgia, tomorrow Ukraine, and the next day the Baltic states. And if he can do in the Baltic states what he's doing in Ukraine and show that Article 5 of NATO is an empty shell, then he's virtually destroyed NATO. And by his flirtation with the extremist parties of the right and the left, which he's been very actively doing, he's also trying in some sense.
In Europe.
In Europe, yes, of the right and the left, the parties that did so well in the recent European parliamentary elections, he's also trying to split the EU. Now, is he sitting at the moment and saying, that's my objective? I don't know. But the problem with Putin is that once he gets going, if he is fed by success and not adequately resisted, those things, I think, come onto his agenda, even if they weren't from the get-go. And that's the risk, I think, and that's how I'd frame it for the president. There's a lot at stake here.
Thank you, Steve. Minister Sikorski, do you agree with this assessment of what Putin wants and how it has evolved?
I agree, and I would add that he has... The negative scenario that he needs to prevent is Ukraine becoming a successful democratic country. That, in his mind, must be an ideological threat to his very power base, because he is right that Russia and Ukraine are brotherly nations. But if the younger brother were to succeed and make become European, more open, have a competitive economy, become like Poland, that would be a dangerous precedent for the Russian people themselves, who might decide that that's a better system than what they have right now. And leaders defend their power base. Now, his positive plan is that he wants to get parity. He, from Russia's point of view, it must be humiliating, as they see it in their own terms, to be a junior partner to practically everyone, to the United States, to Europe, and to China. Now, I think it's undoable for Russia to gain parity with either of those three power centers, because you just cannot do it on the basis of this small an economy. Russian economy is only 250% bigger than Poland's. But he has some advantages: unity of command, armed forces, and intelligence apparatus, and a propaganda apparatus that give him the illusions of strength. I think his grand strategy is not properly thought through, because he would like our union to dissolve so that he can deal with European countries one by one. He would like to create his own multinational union, of which Moscow would be the center. But it's hard to create a multinational union while at the same time stoking Russian ethnic tribal nationalism. Also, if Russia, when Russia itself is a multinational country. So it's going to be very difficult to manage that. There's a contradiction inside the strategy. And also, it's very difficult to manage a union of states while taking their territories away from them. I think he has already scared even the Belarusians and the Kazakhs, who are publicly endorsing his plans, but privately preparing for resistance. So I agree with Stephen. His strategy is bold. He is tactically very agile and flexible. But I just don't see how he can succeed.
I think that's right. I think what's important to note is that as he's attempted to destabilize Ukraine, he has also cracked down domestically. And I think at some level he knows he's playing with fire. The notion that by referendum sections of a country can leave a country is something that is a bad principle for Russia. You know, a referendum in Chechnya not too long ago would have produced an unhappy result. I think he's actually aware of this, which is why he's cracking down domestically, because he figures if anybody tries that in Russia, he can handle them with brute force. So, unfortunately, his strategy internationally requires, in some sense, that he become more authoritarian domestically, which moves Russia further away from the Western consensus rather than toward the Western consensus that you were talking about.
So let me get to the question of, you've talked some about what he wants, you've talked some about his strategy to get it. We can go deeper on the strategy part, but Mr. Sikorski, let's talk about what we can do to prevent it. And your question, the answer to your question is, do we want to win or do we not? Talk about that in the context of this week and President Obama's visit, the $1 billion package. Steve Hadley at this conference has talked about the need for us to retake the initiative. We don't have the initiative. who's got the initiative in this? Are you more convinced from this week and from this package that we want to win? Or are we still really not there? Is Russia just a much more determined player in this than the West is?
I think Russia was succeeding when she was doing some of those things under the radar. When we were assuming that it was broadly converging with us, but Russia was doing a little bit on the margin around its periphery. I think Crimea has changed that because the sight of those Russian soldiers without insignia, President Putin just pretty blatantly saying, these are not my soldiers, and then admitting that these are his soldiers. I think he has personally offended some Western leaders' self-esteem. He has taken advantage of the fact that democracies traditionally are very slow to move. Democracies operate in the mode of trade and are very reluctant to go to a mode of conflict. But he has, I think, almost succeeded in reminding us that conflict is possible again. And I think the process of galvanization has started. You know, as late as 6 months ago, no more, 9 months ago, it was in Europe literally unimaginable that we would be doing any kind of sanctions against Russia. When Russia imposed its trade boycott on Ukraine in August of last year, I was arguing, actually also to President Yanukovych at the time, you know, do you need help with that? He said, nah, we're not Armenia, we'll handle it. But I was also arguing to my European colleagues, look, if our partner, someone with whom we are negotiating a DCFTA, is under a trade boycott, this is not the best time to pile up new conditions on Ukraine. This is a time to neutralize that boycott. I wasn't getting through. And now we are discussing, you know, what sanctions to do and under what conditions. And yes, we've done too little, too late at every stage to affect the other side's calculations in an operational sense. But I think Russia will discover that she's much more connected to the world global economy than North Korea or Cuba, and that this loss of reputation, perceived heightening of commercial risk, downgrades on the financial markets, exclusion of ships and goods and aviation to Crimea, this will all impose costs. And then what we should also do is those things that are under our control, that don't depend on Mr. Putin, and those things that are in our interest anyway. It is in our interest anyway to have lower energy prices, so, and not to pay monopolistic prices to Gazprom. So we should accelerate the building of what my prime minister has launched as the energy union project. Russia has just signed a gas deal with China. And we think the price that was agreed was something in the region of $350-$360 per 1,000 cubic meters. Whatever we pay in Europe above that price is the price of not having an energy union, because China bought like an energy union on behalf of its companies. Mm-hmm. The United States could, of course, help a great deal by really exporting LNG, and what would be particularly useful would be if a small volume of LNG was sent not just generally to the markets, but specifically to Poland and Lithuania. Because that would strengthen this region's energy independence and would be a very powerful geopolitical signal. And also things like the Keystone project that would bring more oil to the markets and bring down the price of oil. And that's something that would get President Putin's attention, because he's clearly a man that is not persuaded by words.
Well,
he will be persuaded by events and actions and economic factors.
Let me pick that up briefly. I believe you've argued that it was U.S. and European action that stopped a Russian invasion. I'm not sure that's an exact quote, but I've seen something of that sort that you've said. Is that true? If so, what is it we did? And the reason I'm asking that is, what do we do in the short term? I agree with you on the energy issues, but what do we do in the next month or two in the West in this situation with a new Ukrainian president? What specific actions are most important?
I think what prevented the wholesale invasion of eastern and southern Ukraine were a number of factors. First of all, the failure of the putsches in Odessa, in Mykolaiv, in Zaporozhye, in Dnipropetrovsk. That was the most important factor. Secondly, the fact that the Russian army is still, to a large degree, a conscript army. And the rotation ended. And so the readiness of Russian forces has just dropped. And they need to train up new recruits. And thirdly, also, I think the threat of the third stage of sanctions. What we should do is also another thing under our control, which is to help Ukraine. I believe Ukraine now has a window of 3 to 4 months before the forces are ready again, and she needs to rebuild its army. She needs to rebuild its internal security apparatus, and you know, the new president has the authority to do that, and we could help on the margin.
Let me turn to you on that, Steve. Yep. Let's get as specific as we can. And this will also come back to you, Minister Sikorski. Has the U.S. done enough? The $1 billion announced this week, you've seen all the various reporting of it and questions about it, positive and negative. You've seen the Poles, Estonians, Mr. Sikorski himself asking for forward basing of NATO troops. You've seen calls for more aid, military aid, lethal aid, different sorts of aid for Ukraine. Is the United States, is the West doing enough?
Well, I want to start there. I think you can't ask it in terms of, is the United States doing enough?
Yeah.
The question is the United States and the EU and NATO collectively doing enough to deal with this problem? And the answer to that, I think, is clearly no. What are the kinds of things we need to be doing more? One is, I think we're doing a terrible job pushing back on the lies that Putin, I mean, he gets away with murder. You know, this call that I was told about to get foreign mercenaries out of Ukraine. I mean, this is laughable. The agents of influence that are in Ukraine are Russian, not Western. So we're letting him get away with this narrative. And that's partly we have to have our national leaders, Europe and the United States, calling out publicly Putin for these lies. And then we need to relook the whole issue about Voice of America, Radio Free Europe, the information campaign, because if it's back to an ideological struggle, that was one of the biggest tools we had in the last ideological struggle. So we've got to get truth out. Secondly, yes, we have to do the issues about sanctions. The problem is, I think we've, because of Iran and other things, we've fallen in love with sanctions as a silver bullet. And my worry is, if we put in sanctions, we think we've solved the problem. And we are going to be with this for a long time. Putin thinks he's going to be there for a long time and have a long-term strategy. And if we do not do now, starting today, the things that will change the strategic landscape over time, we will have recurrent crises. So we got to handle this first one and deter and prevent further crises. So the TTIP, binding Europe and America together in a trade union. And
the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership is a geostrategic move.
It is a geostrategic move. Mm. What we've talked about on energy, alternative ways of getting energy to Europe that are not dependent on Russia. Yes, we have to, I think, shore up the American presence. We can do it in a way that is smart. But if we do not, and we have to then show that the door is open to Europe, to the countries in the East. We need to, I would not be talking about questions, I mean, we can say the door is open and EU membership and NATO membership, that's too long. What we need to be doing right now is the economic assistance to Ukraine, the minister talked about, and I think we need to be helping these countries shore up their defenses, their ability to defend themselves. Not that they could defend themselves alone against the weight of the Russian army, but you can show to Putin that if he goes in, he will pay a cost that is not worth it and will raise a question in the Russians' mind about what he's doing. So my point is, yes, do sanctions. Let's get the information campaign, and then let's do these longer-term things that will change the strategic calculus and will deter future activity by Putin in the future. And my worry is we'll spend all of our effort on the sanctions, and we'll never really quite get the sanctions that people think were in order. And we will not do these more strategic things that will really, in the long term, defeat Putin's strategy. Because that's what we need to do. We need to defeat him in the long term with a strategy that he has.
Thank you, Steve. Minister Sikorski, perhaps you can drill down on two specifics. The forward-basing issue. The formulation this week was persistent presence, enduring presence, but not the permanent bases that I think you've called for, President Ilves, others have called for. I talked to a senior administration official, and he said, look, if you look at the way Russia is threatening, it's not a base that answers that, it's something else. You know the arguments. So on that question, but also the military aid, lethal aid for Ukraine. Are you satisfied? How do you feel about the response on those issues?
Well, we are not hung up on the word permanent because you know nothing is permanent in the world. But we are just at a loss to understand why it's all right to have bases in Germany, in Britain, in Spain, in Italy, in Turkey. And not in Poland. Who are the 55 remaining American troops in Germany defending Germany against? I assure you that Poland is no threat. And I don't think Denmark wants to attack Germany either. I don't know about the French. but I assume not.
Minister Sikorski, a lot of Germans will sleep better tonight after that statement.
And here we have a philosophical problem. Namely, some people across countries think that putting in military capability on the territory of new member states provokes. Now, we think that Ukraine yet again proves that what provokes a bully is not strength, but weakness. If you don't fight back, he will take more. If you draw a line, he will stop. And therefore, the forced posture from the Cold War is anachronistic and needs to be addressed again. And the last 15 years were years of illusion of postmodernist nirvana. Russia and us marching towards highlands of a brave new world. And now we're back in history. We just need to correct some of those things, particularly if we are still serious about NATO enlargement. There is some talk in Wales about enlargement. We have to make the security guarantees that are already outstanding credible before we extend them further, because President Putin has proven that he will test them. And as Stephen says, if he tests them and they fail, then NATO is over, and that will affect everyone.
Thank you for that clear answer. One comment from Steve, and then I'll turn to the audience.
Again, I worry that we will spend all our time in a debate about NATO enlargement, when and whom, EU enlargement, when and whom, which I think we need to do, but we will not do two things in the short run. One, U.S. forces, I was talking to Jim Miller and Walt Slocum about this. You could put pre-positioned equipment in Poland. You can have a small standard presence, a battalion-sized presence, and then rotate forces through. You don't need to put dependents in Poland. But that kind of formulation, pre-position, a small force that is permanent and then rotated in, that will work. Secondly, in terms of strengthening defense capacities of countries, particularly Ukraine, it's not just arms, though I think arms we should do. But there are people here in the conference who have talked about what the Yanukovych administration did to the army. There's no professional army that is reliable and loyal. The number of troops that the government can rely on is, probably less than 10,000, I'm told. So it's, don't think just by arming we've solved the problem. It has to be a long-term program of strengthening the capacity of this country to build an army that is effective and loyal and can help defend its people.
As I turn to the audience, there is also a historical analogy here. Any of you who have not read Berlin 1961, I commend it to you. But a relatively small number of soldiers in West Berlin were hostage to our intent and kept the city free for a very long period of time. And so I think anyone looking at that history might say, I might want to have a few of those troops on my territory. Questions, and I'll see if I can see you. Walt Slocum, and then I see two or three questions already, please. And wait for the microphone to come to you, too.
Thanks. First of all, is this on? Yeah. First of all, thank you for two terrific presentations, and Fred for sharp questions. Copies of Berlin 1961 will be available in the lobby at a very modest markup over the normal retail price. My question is, and it goes back to something Senator McCain said yesterday, Russia is going to be there for a very long time. And what do you see as not only the long-term relationship we need with a Russia, which is not, at least in any short term, going to become a part of the West in a normal sense, but is going to be there, and how do we get there? What's your long-term vision for a stable relationship with a Russia which is not another Poland?
I would say three things. I have not given up the vision of a Europe whole, free, and at peace in which Russia finds its peaceful place. So I'm not prepared at this point to declare Putin an adversary or an enemy, and to call for neo-containment. I think we need to do all the things we've talked about up here to strengthen our position. And I would do it in such a way so that the door will be open to a different kind of Russia that wants to return to be part of the Western consensus. And I think leaving that, so you have a back door for TTIP that allows other countries to join, Turkey, and ultimately, we would hope, Russia. Same thing. You ultimately bring Ukraine into the EU in a way that does not require it to sever its trade ties and historical ties to Russia. But it's also important for the Russian people, for those people who want a democratic future for Russia after Putin. It is important that we leave the door open to give hope to those people, because I don't think Russia is permanently lost. At least I hope not.
Look, Putin feels that the West has put pressure on Russia, countered Russia at every turn. We feel we've gone out of our way to include Russia. You know, under Clinton administration, huge financial assistance to Russia, various assistance with disarmament programs, making the nuclear stuff safe. And institutionally, Russia joined the Council of Europe. We negotiated long and hard and encouraged Russia to join WTO. Poland actually supported Russia joining OECD. We have a partnership and cooperation agreement, a kind of framework one. There is a process which Russia has dropped of negotiating with Russia the kind of agreement we have with Ukraine. It's called PCA 2. Putting the relationship, commercial relationship, and to do with standards, with dispute resolution procedures, and you know, on a firm treaty legal basis, so that we have a stable commercial relationship and more with a very important country, and I still think we were hoping it would happen even under President Putin. You know, I wouldn't go so far as to hint, like you, at regime change, because I think that's unhelpful, that sort of closes the door. It was President Putin who had the opportunity to take Russia in the right direction, as we see it. And I still, he could just about still do it if he turned around.
Thank you. Marcin Zaborowski.
Agree with that.
Right here, sorry. And thanks again for our great partnership, Marcin.
Thank you. Thank you, Fred. I hear a lot of news on how the West is being galvanized here over this issue. I'm just wondering whether the West at the same time is not very alone. When we look into the vote at the UN on the Crimea resolution, we saw India, Brazil abstaining, we saw Argentina, Mexico abstaining, and we saw Israel not showing up. What does it tell us?
Mr. Sikorski.
Well, it was still the most overwhelming vote censoring a major country that I can remember. But yes, in relations to big powers like Russia, countries hedge. You know, nothing new in the world.
Thank you. I let me pick up, too. There's a question on the aisle right there. Sorry. And then the question from my journalistic friend who moderated such a great panel right here after him, please.
My name is Yevhen Lyubovitsky. I'm from Kiev. I'm part of the Nestor Group, which is the independent group of experts that was trying to use the time of Zastoy of Yanukovych to design the long-term vision for Ukraine. And my question to you is, considering that we will have to reintroduce Ukraine to the West, because that's a new Ukraine that's defined its priorities, what would be your assessment of the possible role of Ukraine in the new world? What should Ukraine bring to the table? What should Ukraine's role be in the region? Is that going to be something like Turkey's role in the Muslim world, or is that going to be some other role in a post-Soviet world? What is the type of input that you would like to have from Ukraine in the partnership that's fulfilling?
And let me pick up one more question here.
there is broader consensus between Europe and America what should be done towards Ukraine. Let me ask a simple question. What should the US and Europe not do in Ukraine and leave to the Ukrainian people, a proud nation, to do themselves? Because clearly there are limits of Europe and America doing something. I always wonder what we should not do, quote, impose on the Ukrainians. What is their duty to do?
Okay, so let's start with you, Minister Sikorski, particularly the question of what role Ukraine plays in the region. And looking at the historical situation, is this situation just a lot harder than it was when Poland had to make its transition, partly because of the determination of the opponent, the relative weakness of the West, and the problems internally in Ukraine. So reintroducing Ukraine, and I think there's the other questions related to that, which is what do the Ukrainians have to do themselves?
Yes, we had it easier because we were dealing with Yeltsin's Russia, and Russia was not trying to stop our economic reforms. But Ukraine has it easier in the sense that we were in 1989 bankrupt. We were in default. Ukraine is not in default. It's very close to it, but it's been saved at the last minute by the IMF. And I understand the agreed package of reforms is being implemented, and therefore Ukraine will get a second tranche next month. And that's real money. First tranche was, as I understand, 2.5 or 3 billion. The second one, about the same. All we had was 1 billion zloty stabilization fund from the US, on which we didn't draw. So actually, we had nothing. And we had hyperinflation. We had 800% inflation in 1990. Hmm. Whereas in Ukraine, it's not quite single digits, but certainly not hyperinflation. And the things that Ukraine needs to do are pretty basic. You know, if you stop wasting 7% of your GDP on energy subsidies to waste energy on a heroic scale, you immediately have a source of funds to start fixing other parts of your economy and of your state. Hmm. Now, what Ukraine needs, what role Ukraine should play? This is tricky because I will tell you that the way we saw it, Ukraine was overplaying its hand. Under successive governments. Because Ukraine had the illusion that because the West was vying for it and Russia was vying for it, everybody came and, you know, Mr. Yanukovych, please, please release Yulia and all that. The impression in Kiev was that you are a great power and the world was focused on you. Actually, what you were doing was wasting time. You thought that you were somehow choosing a third way between Russia and the West and playing this sophisticated geopolitical game. Whereas actually, you were wasting time and allowing your country to stagnate. In Poland, we have a saying, the third way leads to the third world. And your successive leaders were trying to maintain an oligarchic kleptocracy based on the Russian model, but without the oil and gas. And that's proven undoable. And you now need to embrace the Western model and create a competitive, demonopolized society in which people can do business other than extracting oil and gas and coal and all those heavy industries. You need a decade to fix your country, because Yanukovych has literally destroyed basic functions of the state and also taken a huge chunk. He was stealing so much that he undermined the functions of the state, right? And it'll take you a decade to rebuild it. And the best thing that you can do is to show that it can be done, that even in a post-Soviet country with all the regional differences, with an entrenched oligarchical system, with rampant corruption, with a hostile neighbor, it can be done. And that would be a great example for other nations in the post-Soviet world to follow, and that would gain you a great deal of authority and soft power. But really, all the work is now done domestically. I wouldn't... you need to rebuild your strength before you can play an international role.
Wonderful answer. Steve, in picking up these questions, also deal with the idea that Dr. Brzezinski has been promoting for some time, which is the Finlandization approach.
For two decades, the West tried to help Ukraine, but Ukraine was not willing to help itself. And you're reaping the whirlwind of two decades of failed leadership. So you've got to do it. We can help, but you've got to do it. And I would say tend to your knitting. If you can do it, as Mr. Sikorski says, it will be, that's the most important contribution you can make. I think labels are the enemy in dealing with this problem. Because when you say Finlandization or containment or Russia as adversary, there's a whole lot of baggage that comes in. So I would stay away from the labels. And I think I would pick up another of Dr. Brzezinski's points. We have the tools, the United States and Europe together, to deal with Putin and his gambit. We are much stronger than he, much weaker. The question is whether we have the wisdom and the will. I think we will, and as Dr. Brzezinski said last night, I think we will succeed. And thirdly, I would avoid the label, but what we need to do is tend to our knitting, move forward on our vision for Europe, whole, free, and at peace, do all the things we've talked about here, while leaving the door open to Russia, not redividing Europe, not unnecessarily isolating Russia. And I think we can do that. And I would hope that Putin would change his mind. I've spent a lot of time dealing with Putin, and I fear we've lost him. And so I would leave the door open, whether for Putin or for whatever that comes after Putin. But I think we focus on the prescription of what we do. And watch out for the labels.
I have one particularly persistent questioner. And so we're going to take one question. This is going to be a three-minute exchange. And then the last thing we want to do is tread on the Ann Applebaum panel that will follow
I'm the persistent questionnaire. Andrew Mikta, Rhodes College. This is actually directed at Steve. And I don't want to sound testy, but I've heard over and over again, not just here, but various venues, about how we must deter, how we must finally send a message, how we must do all these grand things. And then I look at Europe where everybody's cutting their own deals. I hear ringing rhetoric, and I heard a great speech by the president in Warsaw, which to me should be the first step in a series of actions, very specific actions. So I'd like to ask you specifically, brass tacks, what do we do? A Russian Duma parliamentarian, when the crisis started and we started talking about sanctions, said something to the effect, they talk, and then they stop. Why can't Minister Sikorski simply point his question at his allies in Europe and say, we need bases here because it is a concrete deterrent to any potential Russian aggression? And instead I hear we get into rotational this, we maybe do that, maybe we'll do some training, but et cetera, et cetera. Can't we finally recognize what is happening and respond in a direct way and tell Putin what the West is going to do?
I'll point it to that part of it. Should we be doing the bases, break the 1997 agreement? Or do you
we can
agree
do basis
with some...
without breaking the 19th?
Yeah, well, right. The language of the agreement has already been abrogated.
Well, no.
But why don't you both? Why don't
sure.
you both deal with?
Look,
that?
I think actually one of the great things about the last 2 days is the list is pretty clear. We've got to step up an information campaign as we did last go round when we had ideological struggle. We've got to do more serious sanctions. We've got to shore up our military presence here. We ought to put the kind of rotational presence I talked in Poland, which would be adequate to send the message that needs to be sent. We've got to help the countries in NATO and Ukraine and Georgia build up their own defense capacity to increase the cost of Putin if there's an invasion. We've got to do TTIP. We've got to have a new energy strategy. We've got to keep the door open to EU accession and NATO membership down the road. And the interim, do the things that are necessary to get these countries to succeed in providing good governance, economic reform, and security to their people. It's a long list. We should be doing it anyway. It's our vision about a Europe whole, free, and at peace, in which Russia finds its peaceful place. Let's get on with it. We somehow stopped in the middle of the last decade. Let's get going. And that's the message that I take from this conference, and it's a good message.
I think that's absolutely terrific, and I agree with I think a lot of people. The forward basing point, would you support it or not?
Yes, and I would do it the way we talked about, which is pre-position equipment, a small babysitting force for that equipment, and then rotational presence in. That's the smart way to do it. We don't need to go back to the Cold War model of, you know, large footprints and big families coming to live in Europe. We don't need to do it. We can accomplish our objectives in a smarter way. And oddly enough, that is technically not in violation of the understandings between Russia and NATO, though heaven knows he's violated them enough. We should feel free to do so if we need to, but we don't need to. And therefore, we can do it, send the message, and still leave that door open to a changed Russian policy, which we both agreed I think we need to do.
Sorry, final word, Minister Sikorski.
We'll take whatever.
Thank you for that. One thing I said before is that one day I predict every one of you in this audience will look back at this Wroclaw Global Forum and remember that we came together at one of those great moments in history when leaders either made the right decisions or the wrong decisions, and a generation would end up either reaping the profit or paying for the consequences. It's so inspiring to have a leader like Minister Sikorski at this moment in history. It's wonderful, Steve, to still have your voice as such a powerful voice in the transatlantic world and your leadership at the Atlantic Council. Please stay in your seats. We're going to get off the stage as quickly as we can to make way for the other panel, which will again be dealing with the facts, what we can do factually, and really focusing on the soft power elements of all of this. So thank you very much to Minister Sikorski and Steve Hadley.
Thank you. Great being with you.